Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Ye still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again? Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I am yours. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I am yours. I am yours. Let's walk together for a while and ask where we begin to build. And to plan. Let's talk together of a time when we will share a feast where pride and power kneel to serve the lonely and the least, and joy.
Good morning and welcome to worship. My name is Pastor Lisa, and I'm the pastor here at Buda United Methodist Church, and it is grateful to I'm grateful to have you here as part of our virtual worship this morning. I'd like to invite all of you to sign in. You can do that by mentioning who you are in the comments, who's worshiping with you as well. You can take a selfie and post it there, or you can just like this post, and we'll know that you're here worshiping with us this day. To help you participate in worship today, we will have lyrics to the music on the slides, but there's also a song sheet that's posted on this Facebook page if you're interested in it, as well as some coloring pages for the children. Finally, I want to send a message out to all our graduating seniors from high school. We are interested in finding out if we can get a picture of your senior picture, as well as what your plans are in the next year, as much as you can tell us what your plans are right now. We'd love to include that as part of our first service, our service in the first week of June.
Will you pray with me? God the encourager, God the compassionate, God the merciful, disturb us, rouse us from our sleep, lift us into awareness of your presence, change us, move us, mold us for the better, so that at the sound of your voice, at the call of our name, we will never be the same. May our worship do this, and so much more, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise Him, for He is thy help and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration.
prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely his goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do. Praise to the Lord, O let all that is in me adore him. All that hath life and breath come now with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people again, gladly forever.
Each week when we come together, we're invited to think about the week that's gone by, the ways that we have stepped into God's plan for our lives, as well as the way that we have decided to forge our own path. With that, I invite you to join me in the prayer of confession this morning. Forgiving God, we confess that we have judged those who struggle with mental illness. We have judged because we do not understand. Forgive us for making assumptions. Forgive us for our indifference. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers of silence this morning. Let all God's children say, Amen. Hear these words of pardon and assurance, friends. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Be assured that the Almighty and Merciful has offered love and forgiveness to all. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Everybody, we are here today talking about being sick and getting better. In order to talk about that, I wanted to show you some things that we use when we get sick. Here's a thermometer. You probably know what a thermometer is. It tells you if you have a fever, because when you have a fever, that usually means you're pretty sick. I have a Band-Aid. And, you know, the Band-Aids are really good for if you get a cut or something like that. You can put a Band-Aid on there and it helps you get better. I also brought this Visine to show you. I used to always keep Visine in my purse whenever I'd take my boys to the park because they used to get sand in their eyes a lot. And I'd have to wash it out with this. So I used to always keep this in my purse. Now I don't keep it in my purse so much, but I do have it in my medicine cabinet just in case somebody gets something in their eye. So August, can you tell me, have you ever been sick before?
Yes, I have been sick before.
You have been sick, but not really that bad, right?
Yes.
I don't think you've ever been to the hospital. Have you ever broken an arm before? Anything? No, I don't think you have. I broke my arm one time when I was a little girl, and I had to have a cast on my arm for 3 weeks. It was a really long time to have a cast on when I was little. But, you know, we do those things so that we can get better. We put casts on broken bones and things like that. And sometimes we don't even have to go to the doctor. Sometimes we get sick, and we can just stay home from school or rest or maybe have some chicken soup or something like that, and it'll make us feel better. And eventually we usually get healthy again. So most of the time, when we get sick, we get better. Sometimes we don't get all the way better though. Sometimes, especially as we get older, we might have issues with maybe high blood pressure, and we have to keep taking high blood pressure medicine. Or sometimes when we get sick, the doctor will say, okay, well, these are some things you have to do to keep yourself healthy again. my son, I have one son who has to take insulin so that he can process the food that he eats, because his body doesn't make insulin anymore. So he has to always take insulin whenever he eats food. And sometimes that just happens. Sometimes we need to do things in order to keep ourselves healthy, even after we get sick, even after we get mostly better. But do you know something about the church that's really cool? Maybe not everybody knows this.
What?
Especially our Methodist church here. As a Methodist church, when we read the Bible, we see that God, there's a lot of stories in there about God healing people, right? There's a lot of stories about Jesus healing people. So we feel like as a church, it's our job to help people feel better, and it's our job to help people if they don't have access to medical care. So a lot of times we have missions in countries where there might not be a lot of medical care. We send people over there to help people. We send doctors and nurses over to help people that don't have access to medical care. And we also have a lot of resources here in our church. If people get sick or people don't feel well, they can come and they can say, well, what do I do? Where can I get help for this? They can ask the church, and the church will usually try to help them or find ways for them to have access to care. But what is something else that we do as a church for people that are sick?
Pray.
Right, we do. We like to pray for people that are sick, because ultimately, God is the one that heals people, right? God is the one that heals everybody. And so when people get sick, we have a whole prayer team that likes to pray for people that are sick or people that are not feeling well or people that are having problems in their life. So why don't you and I pray right now?
Okay.
Dear Lord, thank you for being with us today. Thank you for being a magnificent healer. And thank you for giving us the time to speak about you and to learn about your word. Amen.
The first scripture reading today is from the third chapter of the book of Lamentations, verses 21 through 23. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The second scripture reading today is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 6, verses 17 through 20. When God wanted to demonstrate to the heirs of the promise that his purpose doesn't change, he guaranteed it with a solemn pledge. So these are two things that don't change, because it's impossible for God to lie. He did this so that we who have taken refuge in him can be encouraged to grasp the hope that is lying in front of us. This hope, which is a safe and secure anchor for our whole being, enters the sanctuary behind the curtain. That's where Jesus went in advance and entered for us, since he became a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Gracious God, as we turn to your word for us this day, may your Holy Spirit rest upon us. Help us to be persistent in our hearing, in our speaking, in our believing, and in our living. Amen. We are in the final week of our four-part sermon series on mental health and wellness. This series has been an overall effort to normalize and bring comfort to discussing some rather difficult, sensitive topics. We've addressed depression and anxiety, brain injury, and dementia. And this week, we're talking about healing. We're talking about how people with all sorts of mental health issues of all degrees can seek wellness. I want to say that I think everyone in the world right now is under some degree of stress, whether it's fear for your health or the economy, your job, or where you will get your next meal. You may just be picking up on the stress of those around you and feeling stress without any distinct worry or concern of your own. Everyone is experiencing some level of stress these days. And prolonged stress like that leads to anxiety and or depression. So when I speak of healing for mental illness, this is pertinent to everyone right now. This week, I've been thinking a lot about someone. Her name was Mrs. Reed. Mrs. Reed took care of me when my mother returned to work after I was born. After having six children, my mother returned to work as a nurse, partly for financial reasons, but I know some of it was also to preserve her own mental health. So when I was too little to be left at home with my brothers and sisters, I stayed with Mrs. Reed, starting from when I was a baby through our half-day kindergarten program in elementary school. Mrs. Reed, you see, lived directly across from our school, so it was very easy for me to walk over there after the school day. Some of my earliest memories are from Mrs. Reed's house. The smell of graham crackers and the sound of ice clinking on the side of a glass of tea. They all bring back memories for me of Mrs. Reed. I stayed connected to Mrs. Reed throughout my childhood and youth, even though I was too old to go there. It was just so easy to walk across the street after school for some graham crackers and milk, and a warm, loving adult who would always listen. So some days, from when I was in first grade through 12th grade, when I just needed to talk, I would cross the street and walk over to her house, knowing each time I would receive a warm welcome. One day, I think I was in middle school, I knocked on her door and Mrs. Reed appeared wearing what I recognized as one of her nicest Sunday dresses. Assuming she was going out, I apologized for interrupting and said I would come back another day. Oh no, she insisted, come on in. I was just about to start cleaning my oven. We can have a nice chat while I work on that. A little puzzled, I followed Mrs. Reed into her kitchen and watched her pull out cleaners and scrubbing brushes and asked, aren't you going to change first? And she gave me a big smile and said, I already did. She went on to explain that whenever she faced a really dirty household task, she would put on her nicest clothes. She explained that she did it for two reasons. One is that it ensured she would be as careful as possible to protect her dress. But it also gave her a better attitude about doing whatever task she was facing. Now, I realize this is not the case for all mental health issues, and I will talk about that in a minute. But over my life, I've come to realize how right Mrs. Reed was, that we can directly impact our mental and emotional state. We can change them by how we approach things around us. As I've thought more about mental health through this sermon series, I've realized that when you're striving for mental wellness on a day-to-day basis, you can separate that into three parts, three goals, if you will. One is your physical health, another is your mental health, and finally, your spiritual health. Physically, there are so many ways to improve your mental health. The right amount of sleep, not too much or too little, is essential. I have personal experience with exercise and the endorphins it produces, working miracles to improve my attitude. And exercise also happens to help you regulate your sleep better. Learning the things that relax you is important too. A walk outside, a cup of tea, a bath, meditation, yoga. Knowing what to do when things seem out of control is essential. And I can't emphasize enough that eating well is so important. Here's my confession. I have a tendency to reach for chocolate when I feel anxious or depressed. And yes, science has determined that chocolate has its benefits, both physically and emotionally. But if that is all I am eating, I physically stop feeling well. Others may find yourself reaching for any food. Or maybe it's caffeine, alcohol, or prescription medication that you reach for. Pick your poison. If you're turning to a substance, legally or illegally, if you're turning to it to make yourself feel better, and whatever it is detrimental to your overall health and well-being, you may be doing what is commonly known as self-medicating. Whatever we consume, what we put into our body, it has a huge impact on our emotional state. It's important not only to avoid the things that are harmful, that we're becoming dependent upon, or that we turn to too often. We need to avoid those things and instead turn to what we know is healthy. When I make sure I get enough fruits and vegetables and some protein, that helps me feel better all around. And as a result, I feel better physically and emotionally. Mentally, now that's what drove Mrs. Reed to put on her Sunday best in order to clean her oven. She knew that if she approached this dreaded task looking her best, she would also feel better. Healthy thinking, keeping your thoughts positive, can help your mood as well. Recognizing triggers that cause a downward spiral is also essential. Keeping your mind distracted with small, achievable tasks really helps as well. Make a list, check off those small tasks as they finish them so that you feel like you've accomplished something. Keeping a structure to your day is also essential. This helps you avoid laying around and sleeping too much. Before we knew it would be months in social isolation, not just a couple of weeks sheltering in place. I know a lot of people who didn't set an alarm in those early days, who sat around in sweats or pajamas all day, napped, and then stayed up all night. For a week or two, it's kind of like vacation. But if you let that drag on, it isn't healthy. Set an alarm, get up, exercise, spend some time with God, shower, get dressed in real clothes. Keep a schedule so that you can be mentally alert. There are two other pieces to the physical and mental picture that I want to add here. For some, the steps that I've outlined, they won't be enough. The path to wellness for some may not be as linear as it is for others. There may be setbacks and snags, detours, reroutings. For some of us, we may not be able to do this on our own. We may need to take more steps, such as medication or counseling. And that's okay. It's even a faithful response. I hear people dismiss psychotherapy as a crutch or say they would never take antidepressants. There are some people who need one or both of these to get their lives rebalanced. Seeking out help is smart. It shows signs of your strength that you can admit that you need help. It is not a weakness. Let me ask you this. For all those people with cancer, is taking chemotherapy a crutch for them? If someone takes high blood pressure medication, are they faithless? Are they not trusting in God to heal them? Are they not putting their health in God's hands? Would they be more faithful if they gave up taking the medication they need to survive? No. They're being smart and faithful by giving their body what it needs, by consulting doctors and professionals to guide them through their treatment, just like someone who takes antidepressants and seeks out a counselor. You know, people went to Jesus for all kinds of healing, physical, mental, and emotional. They went to Jesus because back then they didn't have the resources we have, such as antidepressants and psychologists. Yes, they had herbs, and we do too, but they did not have the science and fact-based knowledge that we have to rely on today. I want you to hear me say that needing more help than you can muster on your own when taking care of yourself physically and mentally is still not working, then seek help, please. Each week I've shared with you at the end of the sermon resources for getting that help, and I'm going to do so again today. So I'm warning you now in case you've missed it. I'm warning you early so you can grab a pen and paper or get ready to snap a shot of that screen with your camera on your phone, that the list will come at the end of this sermon and you'll want to have it. But let me reiterate that just as people went to Jesus, a professional healer in his day, then so you can also seek professional help when you need it. It is a faithful response. We've covered in brief how to manage our physical and mental needs for mental wellness. But what about the spiritual side? We've spent the past 3 weeks immersed in scriptures that showed us the need for mental health and wellness has been with us for a long time. It's nothing new. So how does nurturing our spiritual needs affect our mental health? We are blessed to have a God who loves us deeply, who is with us no matter what we're going through, a God who responds to us with grace and mercy. And I think the key lies in our very real hope in hanging on to this truth, that God loves us deeply. Hope is believing that no matter what happens, no matter what we're going through, that there is something more positive on the other side. Our hope tells us that we know how this story ends. We know that God's love wins every time. Our scripture passages that we shared today are two of my favorites that I turn to when I need a reminder of this hope. And I found myself reading these frequently over the last 2 months. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. This is what I call to mind, and then I have hope. Friends, it doesn't get better than that. The author of Lamentations was writing after witnessing the fall of Jerusalem and the fall of the temple. The author's grief is palpable. In Lamentations, the author was surrounded by poverty and hunger, along with destruction and grief. The book, it's called Lamentations for a reason. But in the midst of all this, the author wrote these words about hope, about God's never-ceasing love. That preaches way better than I ever could. And then there's our passage from Hebrews. The author wants to reassure us here, reassure all of us, we who are heirs of God's promises, all of us are encouraged to grasp that hope that's right in front of us, the hope that's a safe harbor, an anchor for us to cling to. It's right there for us to grasp. The hope that Jesus has gone before us, acting on our behalf. Christ chose us, saved us, sealed us with the Holy Spirit. And it's Christ who's promised to return for us and take us home. That is our hope that we can grasp. That is the hope that we can cling to for mental health and wellness. Friends, I'm not sure what drew you here today. Maybe this is your Sunday habit. Maybe you join me every Sunday. Maybe a friend or a family member encouraged you to check us out. Maybe you were scrolling through Facebook and our video popped up. Whatever reason you ended up here watching this video today, I want you to know and hear something. Because you are here, you are one of us, one of God's beloved children. You are invited to be part of this church, God's church. It's through the church that we grow into our identity as Christ followers, where we find our purpose, our call to love God and our neighbors, where we intentionally choose to live out this life here and now among our brothers and sisters. And you are invited to be part of our family, whether you live in Buda or across the United States or across the world. We invite you to seek physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual wellness with us. And if you need more support than we can give you, if you need the help of professionals to face whatever you're struggling with, here are those contact numbers that I promised earlier. Now I invite you to join me in praying for the offering this morning. Loving God, we pray this day for all who are striving for mental health and wellness. And God, today we recognize that that means each one of us. Help us to know where to turn and what steps to take that we will be able to continue to transform into the people you would have us be. And God, receive these gifts that we are returning to you today. Help us use them in such a way that more people will learn to see your light, your love, and your hope. Amen.
We believe in things that we cannot see. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? Hands that heal can set a chained man free. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? We believe in peace in every heart. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? Burning brightly, brightly in the dark. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? So come on, darling, feel your spirits rise. Come on, children, open up your eyes. God is all around, Buddha's at the gate. Allah hears your prayers, it's not too late. And we believe in things that will give us hope. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? Let your voice be heard. Celebrate your vote. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? So come on, darling, feel your spirits rise. Come on, children, open up your eyes. God is all around, Buddha's at the gate. Allah hears your prayers, it's not too late. We believe in things that make us all the same. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? Love belongs to all in deed and name. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? We believe in things that can't be done. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? Lift up your heart, put down your gun. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? We had heroes once and we will again. Why shouldn't we? Come on, darling. Come on, children. God is all around. Buddha's at the gate. Allah hears our prayers. It's not too late. Come on, darling, feel your spirits rise. Come on, children, open up your eyes. God is all around, Buddha's at the gate. Allah hears your prayers, it's not too late. Why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks.
We've come to that time in the service where we're going to ask you to participate fully. We realize that you come to worship this morning with heavy hearts as well as with joys, and we'd like you to share those by lifting them up where you are in your space at home or by typing them into the comments section here. Will you pray with me? God, we come here this morning with heavy hearts, with things that are weighing us down. As we share them, we ask that you hold each one of them in your hands, knowing your hands are the only ones that are big enough to do so. God, we know that each morning has its new blessings, and we ask that you help us open our eyes to see all the grace and beauty that surrounds us. With that, we lift up to you all the joys that we have this morning. Thank you. God, we pray all this and one thing more using the words Jesus taught the disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I will come to you in the silence. I will lift you from all your fears. You will hear my voice. I claim you as my choice. Be still and know I am here. I am hope for all who are hopeless. I am eyes for all who long to see. In the shadows of the night, I will be your light. Come and rest in me. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me. I will bring you home. I love you and you are mine. I am strength for all the despairing, healing for the ones who dwell in shame. All the blind will see, the lame will all run free, and all will know my name. I am the word that leads all to freedom. I am the peace the world cannot give. I will call your name, embracing all your pain. Stand up now, walk and live. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me, I will bring you home. I love you and you.
And now will you hear these words of benediction? I want to read the chorus from that last song we just sang. And I want you to envision that God is saying these to you, to you. Do not be afraid. I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me. I will bring you home. I love you, and you are mine. Go in peace.
Go now in peace, never be afraid. God will go with you each hour of every day. Go now in faith, steadfast, strong, and true. Out to others. so all the world can see. God will be